Dear students, your attention is invited to lecture number 1 on the subject of physics of atom and atomic nucleus. The lecture theme, thermal radiation and Planck's postulate. At a meeting of the German Physical Society on December 14, 1900, Max Planck read his paper on the theory of the energy distribution law on the normal spectrum. This paper, which first attracted little attention, was the start of a revolution in physics. The date of its presentation is considered to be the birthday of quantum physics, although it was not until a quarter of the century later that modern quantum mechanics, the basis of our present understanding, was developed by Schrödinger and others. In the true relativity, quantum physics represents a generalization of classical physics that includes the classical laws as special cases. Just as relativity extends the range of application of physical laws to the region of higher velocities, so quantum physics extends that range to the region of small dimensions. And just as a universal constant of fundamental significance, the velocity of light c characterizes relativity, so a universal constant of fundamental significance, now called Planck's constant h, characterizes quantum physics. It was while trying to explain the observed properties of thermal radiation that Planck introduced this constant in his 90 paper. The radiation emitted by a body as a result of its temperature is called thermal radiation. All bodies emit such radiation to their surroundings and absorb such radiation from them. If a body is first hotter than the surroundings, it will cool off because its rate of emitting energy exceeds its rate of absorbing energy. When thermal equilibrium is reached, the rates of emission and absorption are equal. Matter in a condensed state, i.e. solid or liquid, emits a continuous spectrum of radiation. The details of the spectrum are almost independent of the particle material of which a body is composed, but they depend strongly on the temperature. At ordinary temperatures, most bodies are visible to us not by the emitted light, but by the light they reflect. If no light shines on them, we cannot see them. At very high temperatures, however, bodies are self-luminous. We can see them glow in a darkened room, but even at temperatures as high as several thousand degrees Kelvin, well over 90% of the emitted thermal radiation is invisible to us, being in the infrared part of the electrodynamic spectrum. Therefore, self-luminous bodies are quite hot. Consider, for example, heating an iron poker to higher and higher temperatures in a fire, periodically withdrawing the poker from the fire long enough to observe its properties. When this poker is still at a relatively low temperature, it radiates heat, but it is not visible hot. With increasing temperature, the amount of radiation that the poker emits increases very rapidly, and visible effects are noted. The poker assumes a dual red color when a bright red color and a very high temperatures at intensive blue-white color. That is, with increasing temperature, the body emits more thermal radiation and the frequency of the most intense radiation becomes higher. The relation between the temperatures of a body and the frequency spectrum of the emitted radiation is used in a device called an optical pyrometer. This is essentially a rudimentary spectrometer that allows the operator to estimate the temperature of a hot body such as a star, but observing the color or frequency composition of the thermal radiation that it emits. There is a continuous spectrum of radiation emitted. The eye seeing chiefly the color corresponding to the most intense emission in the visible region. Familiar examples of the objects which emit visible radiation include hot coals, lamp filaments, and the sun. Generally speaking, the detailed form of the spectrum of the thermal radiation emitted by a hot body depends somewhat upon of the composition of the body. However, experiments show that there is one class of the hot bodies that emits thermal spectra of a universal character. These are called black bodies, that is, bodies that have surfaces which absorb all this of the thermal radiation incident upon them. The name of is appropriate because such bodies do not reflect light and appear black when their temperatures are low enough that they are not self-luminous. One example of a nearly black body would be any object coated with a diffuse layer of black pigment such as lamp black or bismuth black. Another quite different example will be described shortly. Independent of the details of their composition, it is found that all black bodies are at the same temperature emit thermal radiation with the same spectrum. This general fact can be understood on the basis of the classical arguments involving thermodynamic equilibrium. The specific form of the spectrum, however, cannot be obtained from thermodynamic argument alone. The universal properties of the radiation emitted by black bodies make them of particle theoretical interest, and physicists sought to explain the specific features of their spectrum. The spectral distribution of a black body radiation is specified by the quantity R sub T of nu called of the spectral radiancy, which is defined so that R sub T of nu multiplied d nu is equal to the energy emitted per unit time in radiation of frequency in the interval nu to nu plus d nu from a unit area of the surface and absolute temperature T. The earliest accurate measurements of this quantity were made by Lumer and Pinkheim in 1899. They used an instrument essentially similar to the prism spectrometer used in measuring optical spectra, except that special materials were required for the lenses, prisms, etc., so that they would be transparent to the relatively low frequency thermal radiation. The experimentally observed dependence of R sub T of nu on the nu and T is shown in figure 1.1. Distribution functions of which spectral radiancy is an example are very common in physics. For example, the Maxwellian speed distribution function tells us how the molecules in a gas at a fixed pressure and temperature are distributed according to their speed. Another distribution function is the one which has the form of decreasing exponential, specifying the times of decay of radioactive nuclei, an example containing nuclei of a given species, and they have certainly seen in a distribution function for the grades received on a physics exam. The spectral radiancy distribution function on figure 1.1 for a black body of a given area and a particle temperature, say 1000 degrees Kelvin, shows us that first, there is very little power radiated in the frequency interval of fixed size dV, d nu, if that interval is at a frequency nu, which is a very small compared to 10 power 14 Hz. the power is 0 for nu equal to 0. Second, the power radiated in the interval d nu increases rapidly as nu increases from the very small value. Third, it maximizes for a value of nu approximately equals 1.1 multiplied 10^14 power hertz. That is, the radiated power is most intense at the frequency. For above approximately equal 1.1 multiplied 10^14 power hertz, the radiated power drops slowly but continuously as the nu increases. It is zero again when nu approaches infinitely large values. The two distribution functions for the higher values of temperature, 1500 Kelvin degrees and 2000 Kelvin degrees, displayed in the figure, show us that 5. The frequency at which the radiated power is most intense increases with increasing temperature. Inspection will verify that this frequency increases linearly with temperature. 6. The total power radiated in all frequencies increases with the increasing temperature, but it does so more rapidly than linearly. The total power radiated in a particle temperature is given simply by the area under the curve for the temperature. R sub t equal integral from 0 to infinity R sub t of nu multiplied d nu. Since R sub t of nu multiplied d nu is the power radiated in the frequency interval from nu to nu plus d nu. The integral of the spectral radiancy R sub t of nu over all nu is the total energy emitted per unit time per unit area from a blackbody at temperature T. It is called the radiancy R. As we have seen in the preceding discussion in figure 1.1, R sub T increases rapidly with increasing temperature. In fact, this result is called Stefan's law, and it was first stated in 1879 in the form of the empirical equation R sub T equal sigma multiplied T 4 power, where sigma equal 5.67 multiplied 10 to minus 8 power watt divided meter square multiplied Kelvin degree 4 power is called the Stefan-Boltzmann constant. Figure 1.1 also shows us that the spectrum shifts toward higher frequencies as T temperature increases. This result is called Wien's displacement law. Nu sub max proportional temperature, where nu sub max is the frequency nu at which R sub T of nu has in maximum value for the particular T. As T increases, nu sub max is displaced toward higher temp frequencies. All these results are in agreement with the familiar experiences discussed earlier, namely that the amount of thermal radiation emitted increases rapidly. The poke radiates much more heat energy at higher temperatures, and the principal frequency of the radiation becomes higher. The poke changes color from dull red to blue-white with increasing temperature. Another example of blackbody, which we shall see to the particularly important, can be found by considering an object containing a cavity which is connected to the outside by the small hole, as in figure 1.2. Radiation incident upon the hole from the outside enters the cavity and is reflected back and forth by the walls of the cavity, eventually being absorbed on these walls. If the area of the hole is very small compared to the area of the inner surface of the cavity, a negligible amount of the incident radiation will be reflected back through the hole. Essentially, all of the radiation incident upon the hole is absorbed. Therefore, the hole must have two properties of the surface of a blackbody. Most blackbodies used in laboratory experiments and constructed along these lines. Now assume that the walls of the cavity are uniformly heated to a temperature T. Then the walls will emit thermal radiation, which will fill the cavity. The small fraction of this radiation incident from the inside upon the hole will pass through the hole. Thus the hole will act as an emitter of the thermal radiation. Since the hole must have the properties of the surface of the blackbody, the radiation emitted by the hole must have a blackbody spectrum. But since the hole is merely sampling the thermal radiation present inside this cavity, it is clear that the radiation in the cavity must also have a blackbody spectrum. In fact, it will have a blackbody spectrum characteristic of the temperature T on the walls, since this is the only temperature defined for the system. The spectrum emitted by the hole in this cavity is specified in terms of the energy flux R sub T of nu. It is more useful, however, to specify the spectrum of radiation inside the cavity called cavity radiation in terms of energy density rho sub T of nu, which is defined as the energy contained in the unit volume of the cavity at temperature T in the frequency interval nu to nu plus d nu. It is evident that these quantities are proportional to one another, that is, rho sub T of nu proportional R sub T of nu. Hence, the radiation inside a cavity whose walls are at temperature T has the same character as the radiation emitted by the surface of a blackbody at temperature T. It is convenient experimentally to produce a blackbody spectrum by means of a cavity in a heated body with a hole on the outside, and it is convenient in theoretical work to study blackbody radiation by analyzing the cavity radiation, because it is possible to apply very general arguments to predict the properties of the cavity radiation. Example 1.1. A. Since A multiplied V equals C, the constant velocity of light, wind displacement law 1.3a can also be put in the form lambda sub max multiplied T equals constant, where lambda sub max is the wavelength at which a spectral radiancy has its maximum value for a particular temperature T. The experimental determinant value of the wind's constant is equal 1.898 multiplied 10 to minus 3 power meter multiplied Kelvin. If we assume that the stellar surfaces behave like blackbodies, we can get a good estimate of their temperature by measuring lambda submax. For the sum lambda submax equals 5100 angstrom, whereas for the north star lambda sub max equals 3500 angstrom. Find the surface temperature of the stars. 1 sun angstrom equals 10 to minus 10 power meter. For the sun, temperature equals 1.898 multiplied 10 to minus 3 power meter, multiplied Kelvin, divided 5100 multiplied 10 minus 10 power minus 10 power meter equals 5700 Kelvin. For the north star, temperature equal 8300 degree Kelvin. At 5700 degree Kelvin, the sun's surface is near the temperature at which the greatest part of its radiation lies within the visible region of the spectrum. The sagas that over the ages of the human evolution, our ears have adapted on the sun, it become most sensitive to this wavelength which radiates most intensively. B. Using Stefan's laws 1.1, 1.2 and the temperatures just obtained to determine the power radiated from 1 cm to power of the stellar surface. For the Sun, R sub 2 equals 6000 watt to cm square. For the North Star, R sub 2 sub T equals 27,000 watt to cm square.